Pursuing righteousness. What does it mean to be righteous? To be righteous means to be right with God. In other words, it means to be right in God's eyes, as measured by the standard of God's holy law, which is summarized in Exodus 20 and in Deuteronomy 5. To pursue righteousness means to actively seek to become right with God by doing something that pleases God. Is this something that we should do? Here in Romans 9, verse 30 to 33, God says that the Gentiles are not pursuing righteousness, and the Jews are jealously pursuing righteousness, but the ones obtaining righteousness are the children of the promise. In Romans 9, verse 30, who are the children of the promise? The first example of the children of the promise was Isaac, verse 9. The second example was Jacob, in verse 13, but not Esau. The third example of the children of the promise were all those on whom God will have mercy, in verse 15, which refers to all the elect. The fourth example of the children of the promise is stated negatively in verses 17 and 18. They are all those whom God will harden, which refers to all the reprobate. The fifth example of the children of the promise is stated in verses 21 and 23, which are called vessels unto honor and vessels of mercy, which refers to all the elect. The sixth example of the children of the promise is stated negatively in verses 21 and 23. They are called vessels unto dishonor and vessels of wrath. The seventh example of the children of the promise is stated here in verses 30 to 33. And they are those who have obtained righteousness out of faith. Let us now read these verses of the seventh example. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles which followed not after righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, for they stumbled at the stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Why does this passage begin with, what shall we say then? God reminds us that in verse 24, he spoke of the vessels of mercy who are the remnant from the Jews and the remnant from the Gentiles. In verse 27 again, God said that only a remnant would be saved. And in verse 29, God said that if it were not by the presence of the remnant in our midst, we would have been destroyed long time ago. Therefore God says here in verse 30, what shall we say then? And now God speaks about the Gentiles. God does not speak about all the Gentiles, but only about a remnant from the Gentiles who become saved. How did they become saved? These Gentiles did not pursue the righteousness of God. They received it freely because they belonged to the elect of God. They did not strive to become righteous before God. They did not have to work for it. They received the righteousness that is by faith, which means that they freely, by grace, receive faith from God, which enabled them to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thereby they would know that they already were righteous before God. It was not so with the Jews. God says in verse 31 that Israel, meaning the Jews, who were born as descendants of Jacob, pursued after righteousness. They did their level best to be right with God by obeying the law as much as they could. And yet, they did not become right with God as judged by his holy law, except for the remnant saved by grace. They still remained unsaved. We read in Romans 10, verse 1 and following verses, Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a seal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own, have not submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. You see, there is where their problem was. They have not submitted themselves to the salvation program that God provided through Jesus Christ. Instead, they have decided to establish their own plan of salvation. But the Buddhists and the Muslims and the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses have also decided to establish their own plan of salvation, and therefore they are still unsaved. The Roman Catholics and the Charismatic Gospels have also decided to establish their own plan of salvation, and therefore they are still unsaved. If they die in this unsaved condition on the last day, they will be sentenced and they will be cast into hell for sure. But as concerning national Israel, God predicted that many among them shall stumble, in Isaiah 8, verse 13 till 15. In Isaiah chapter 8, God commanded not to fear worldly powers which are about to cross our nation. God commanded to fear them, to fear him, and to trust him alone. And then God prophesied something that reaches all the way to us today. God said in Isaiah 8, verse 13 to 15, Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread, and he shall be a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling and for a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel, for a chin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken. In other words, set apart Jehovah of hosts for yourself. He must be whom you reverence, and he must be of whom you shall be afraid. if you have done something wrong. Notice that the words "let him be" are in italics, which means that they were not in the original Hebrew manuscripts. This is understandable because we do not let God be this or let God be that. The God of the Bible is sovereign. He does not take his assignments from mortal man. He is Almighty God. We do not seek him, but he seeks us out. And he bestows his grace upon those on whom he is pleased to give it. Then he shall be our sanctuary. Then he shall be our hiding place from the turmoil of this world. On the other hand, Jehovah of hosts shall be for a stone of stumbling and for a rock of offense to those in Judah and in Israel, for whom he is not a sanctuary. In fact, according to verse 14, Jehovah of hosts is going to be for a trap and for a snare to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, which is now, which is in bondage with her children. What does all this mean? Obviously, the stone of stumbling and the rock of offense are throughout the scriptures titles used for the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, Jehovah of hosts, or the Lord of hosts, also refers to the Lord Jesus Christ. He would be a stone of stumbling to the Jews. Actually, the name stone of stumbling does not convey to the true meaning. In that name, it seems as if God is waiting for the stumbling of man before God will condemn him. Literally, it means stone of smiting, because God does the smiting and God uses the wickedness of man to carry out his plan of smiting the reprobate of the Jews with their unbelief, especially when they delivered up Jesus to be crucified. Then, when the Lord Jesus was exalted, he became a high rock, which could no more be pushed around or killed. Then he became their rock of offense. It is offensive to the Jews today to mention the name of Christ. They are not just uninterested unbelievers, but they are active opponents of the gospel of Christ. If you go to the nation of Israel today and hand out tracts, you will be put in jail, no question asked. And he will be for a trap and for a snare to them on Judgment Day, and they will have to give account of their unbelief in the resurrected Christ, in spite of what the Roman soldiers at the tomb witnessed to them. God says in Isaiah 8 verse 15, "And many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken." This refers to the judgment on the last day, where God uses language that pictures metaphors of white animals that are caught and taken to be killed. God says, "Many among them shall stumble." Today we realize that it is the majority of the Jews which remain in unbelief. In Isaiah 28, verse 16, God speaks about the same stone of stumbling, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. But now God speaks about him as a cornerstone. Isaiah 28, verse 16, "Therefore, thus said the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. Let us first figure out what Zion means. Where is Zion? Zion is the place where God resides. Presently, God resides in heaven, and God resides in the souls of those who have become born again. The Lord Jesus Christ is presently in Zion, in heaven. Presently, Zion is not Jerusalem. When God said, "Behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone," God does not mean that he has put the Lord Jesus in Jerusalem to be crucified. Christ did not become a foundation until after his crucifixion and resurrection and ascension into heaven. It was only then that he became the foundation for the church, beginning at Pentecost. Fix this in your memories. Zion is the place where God resides. The Lord Jesus Christ is our precious cornerstone in heaven. He is our sure foundation, because he qualified to be the spotless, sinless Lamb of God, and he qualified to be our high priest, who offered this spotless Lamb of God at Golgotha. And because he was successful in paying the equivalent of the full price for the guilt of our sins on the cross, he qualified to be our precious cornerstone in heaven. For the reprobate, he will not be a cornerstone, but he will be a stone of stumbling. But why and how do they stumble? In 1 Peter 2, verse 6 to 8, God repeated what he said in Isaiah 8 and in Isaiah 28. But God restated it in a slightly different words. Some intellectuals say that these words come out of the Septuagint, which is a translation of the Hebrew Old Testament in the Greek language. That is a bunch of nonsense. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. But the Septuagint is not an inspired book. If it happens to agree with the Septuagint, fine. But when we believe that God dictated the entire Bible, the New Testament, as well as the Old Testament, to the holy man of old, here we read in 2 Peter 2, verse 6, "Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded," but means ashamed. "Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious, but unto them which are disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed." Now we can answer the question, why do they stumble? Or did they stumble? For example, why did the Jews not believe Jesus? And why did they deliver him to be crucified? 1 Peter 2 verse 8 gives the answer. "And they stumbled at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed." They were appointed to be among the reprobate. Of course, we must set up front that God cannot be the author or the instigator of sin. But surely, for the glorification of the elect, the blood of the Savior must flow. But if the blood is to flow, there must be a wicked and reprobate world to shed it. There must be a Judas who betrays him. There must be a Sanhedrin that condemns him. And there must be a mighty and godless Roman power that finally brings him to the cross. And all this, the reprobate serve for the glorification of the elect. Without that ungodly world, the cross cannot be imagined. But the situation is also thus in the world, in crucifying the Savior, through which it serves for the glorification of the elect, becomes ripe for destruction. Therefore, in the unity of God's plan, reprobation necessarily serves election. God's love towards his people reigns supreme in his counsel. To reveal and to realize this love fully, God brings into existence people who must finally be damned. And is this not a frightening thought? God could also have sovereignly reprobated us. Thank God that he loved us from before the foundation of the world. Thank God that he sent the Lord Jesus Christ to pay for our sins and make his payment available in our lifetime. Our thanks to God must be overflowing all the day. This is the Lord's doing, Matthew 21, verse 40 to 43. Again, we are confronted with God's sovereign design for the outworking of his plan of salvation. In Matthew chapter 21, the Lord Jesus Christ spoke a parable to the chief priest and to the elders of the people. It was the parable of the wicked vine dressers. A certain householder represented God, planting a vineyard, and he rented it out to vine dressers. The vineyard represents the kingdom of God, which was given in custody to the nation of Israel, and they were to take care of it and make it bear fruit and bring the fruit of the kingdom in the form of saved souls back to the king. But the vine dressers were wicked. When the king sent them his servants, they beat up his servants, and some of them they put to death. Last of all, the king sent to them his son, and they also killed his son. Now verse 40. Matthew 21, verse 40. When the Lord therefore of the vineyard cometh, what will he do unto those husbandmen? They say unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men and will let out his vineyard to other husbandmen, which shall render him the fruits in their season. In other words, the king will avenge himself on these wicked vine dressers, and he will make other arrangements for his vineyard. Then we read in verse 42, Jesus said unto them, did you never read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected The same is become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The son of the king, which the wicked vine dressers killed, was the stone which the builders rejected. This stone, representing his resurrected son, became the cornerstone of the foundation on which the apostles and prophets have built the church, which is the outwardly visible part of the kingdom of God here on earth. Then the Lord Jesus said in verse 43, Matthew 21, verse 43, therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation that bringeth forth the fruits thereof. When did this happen? When was the kingdom of God taken away from the spiritual leaders of the Jews? It was taken away at a cross. When the Lord Jesus died on the cross, God tore the curtain in a temple separating the Holy of Holies to the rest of the temple from top to bottom. And it was at Pentecost that the kingdom of God was given to another nation, a nation of the family of Christ, the Israel of God. Let me bring up verse 42 again. The Lord Jesus said there, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. What was the Lord's doing? The king rented out his vineyard to wicked vine dressers. That was the Lord's doing. The king sent his servants, the prophets, to the wicked nation. That was the Lord's doing. The king sent his son, whom he knew was going to be rejected. That was the Lord's doing. The son was going to be tortured and crucified. That was the Lord's doing. The son would rise again from the dead and ascend into heaven. That was the Lord's doing. So we see that God orchestrated the entire history of the nation of Israel, and God orchestrated the incarnation of the Lord Jesus Christ and the entire life of the Lord Jesus. God orchestrated the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God orchestrated the entire mission work of the Apostle Paul and the life of the church throughout the entire New Testament era. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Now let us look at verse 44 and consider the ones who are broken in spirit. Matthew 21, verse 44, and Psalm 51, verse 17. First Matthew 21, verse 44. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but whosoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. Sorry. What does this mean? It means whosoever shall fall down on this stone shall be broken in spirit. He shall realize that this is the Christ, the cornerstone that God has put in place so that we all may fall down on him and worship him. And we come to Christ, when we come to Christ, we do not come with our own agenda, but we come to worship him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His will must become our will. His will has not become our will. Then we are still in the sin of pride. And we have not been broken in spirit. Does God want us to feel small in His sight? Does God first make us go through much suffering? Does God require a broken spirit? Indeed, He does. God says in Psalm 51, verse 17, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, Thou wilt not despise." Contrite means repentant. A broken spirit and a repentant heart, the Lord will not despise. How does God break our spirit? For example, God brings much grief into our life. This grief is really a result of our own sins. And when we are at our wit's end, we turn to God for help. The reprobate do not see it this way. The reprobate ascribes the pains and the hurts in his life to the fault of others. They always blame somebody else. Therefore, they do not see the guiding hand of God in their life. They might talk to their friends, and their friends do not see God's guiding hand. So God's providence remains a mystery to them. And that is how the reprobate never have a broken and a contrite spirit. But now let us look at the second half of Matthew 21, verse 44. The Lord Jesus said there, "But on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder." It means that Christ will come as the shots on the last day, and He will fall with a mighty hand on all the reprobate and cast them into hell. But Jews and Gentiles do not like to go to hell. The Gentiles have whisked God out of their lives, so they do not have to deal with God anymore. The Jews have whisked their own God to a cease, so that they can serve Him according to the instruction of the rabbis, and they claim to know the law of righteousness, Romans 9 verse 30 to 32 and Galatians 3 verse 10. We have seen why the Jews rejected Christ as their cornerstone. It is because God rejected them. Now, let us see how they reasoned in their minds why they should reject Christ. How can we know their minds? Well, God describes their minds in Romans 9, verse 30 to 32. And there we read, "What shall we say then? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, for they stumbled at that stumbling stone." Israel eagerly pursued to become right with God. They wanted to be justified in the sight of God, because they did not want to go to hell. But they did it man's way. They worked and worked and worked to fulfill the law and all its demands on their lives. And they believed that God owed them a seat in heaven because of all their work. But God was not impressed. After all that work, God said, Israel had not attained to the law of righteousness. They did not make even 1% on the way. God sent the Galatian churches a letter by the hand of the Apostle Paul dealing with these issues. What about the law? Do we still obey the law of Moses? The Judaizers who claimed to be experts on the law of Moses swayed the churches in Galatia, which were all Gentile churches. But then God says in Galatians 3 verse 10, there we read, for as many as are the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone that continued not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. This could not be stated clearer. God said that everyone who tries to be right with God through the works of the law is under the curse of God. It is not possible that anyone might be right with God by fervently obeying the law. In fact, God emphasized this again in Galatians 3 verse 21, where God said, is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given, which could have given life, fairly righteousness should have been by the law. If there had been a remote possibility that anyone might become saved by obeying the law, any law, then Christ would not have to suffer and die on the cross, because righteousness would be obtainable by obeying that law. And that would have been the path to righteousness that God would have established. But the fact is that such a law does not exist. Therefore, there is man's way and there is God's way. Man's way is to imagine a God of our own size who acts and thinks like we do, and so we can serve him the way we imagine we would like to be served. But God's way is not like man's way. God says, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God is not pleased with religious fanatics who try to be pleasing to God by their works of the law, like the Jews do. Their argument is, we do not need Jesus. We can be pleasing to God without Jesus, thank you. And so, they do not see their need for a Savior. But God says that everyone is in need of a Savior, because without him, we are on our way to hell. Therefore, God gives faith to whom he will. And that faith really is an evidence of our salvation, but it is not the cause of our salvation. If our law of faith would be the cause for our salvation, then God would not be sovereign. God would have to wait to see if somebody would take the action to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then would God bestow salvation on that person. But then election would not exist. And so one part of the Bible would contradict another part. This cannot be. Therefore, Our faith cannot be the cause of our salvation. Our faith is a gift of God, and it is the evidence of salvation. God gives salvation to everyone who believes, Romans 9, verse 33. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Whosoever believeth on him, nobody out of his own initiative will believe on Jesus, because God declared that we are all born dead in trespasses and sins. And so, the only ones who ever would believe on Jesus are those to whom God will give a measure of faith. Let me now summarize Romans 9. The beginning of part of Romans 9 titled dealt with Isaac as a prime example of those who have been elected unto salvation by the grace of God. The story of Isaac and Ishmael is the story of election and reprobation. Not all the children of the flesh of Abraham were called children of God. Abraham fathered 8 sons, of which only one, Isaac, was beloved of God. The next part dealt with Jacob and Esau, especially with the verse, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. This is another story of election and reprobation. It is recorded that Esau did some horrible things, like selling his birthright, but Esau did not reprobate himself. Esau did these things because he was a reprobate. God loved Jacob in spite of what he did. Next we read, I have mercy, dealing with the wisdom and the knowledge that God exercises in his dealings with sinful man. God is not unrighteous that he will condemn people to hell when they deserve to come to Jesus. Our God is a just God. He will not be unfair. Therefore, we must trust that his decisions are right and good. Then we read the secret providence of God, dealing with God's hardening of the hearts of the reprobate and softening the hearts of his elect. God does that. Does anyone object? Only those who are reprobate will object, because they do not believe the whole counsel of God. God's election refers to the mind of God, whereas God's providence refers to his hands. The word of God also tells us, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Paul tells us in Romans 9 that God is the potter and we are the clay. The potter made of the same lump, Adam, vessels unto honor and vessels unto dishonor. These are also called vessels of mercy and vessels of wrath, whereby indicating the faith we have, the words we speak, the judgments we have endured or are going to endure. The NVE read about the vessels of mercy which God has chosen from all the nations and kindreds and people and tongues, but of both Jews and Gentiles. God's effective call to all his elect was prophesied 2700 years ago by the prophet Hosea, whereby the remnant of the Gentiles, who formerly were called not my people, are called the people of the living God. Then we read about the remnant, which is dealing with all the remnant chosen by grace. God fought for the remnant of Israel, and God fought for the remnant of Gibeon in the valley of Gibeon. And for their sakes, God was willing to make the sun and the moon stand still for a whole day. It is only because the remnant is among us that we are not consumed by the wrath of God. In this article, we have been looking at which of the two ways of becoming justified, which are the two ways of pursuing righteousness. Man's way and God's way. Two parties are being compared. The reprobate among the Jews and the elect among the Gentiles. Man's way involves hard work, but zero results. God's way involves a whole lot of more work and a whole lot more suffering. But it is all done by God. And when the work was complete, God turned the work over to us. This is the law of righteousness, which the reprobate Jews do not understand. But the elect among the Gentiles do understand, because God has so written in the Bible. God gives his elect faith to put their trust in Christ. And since Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth, God gives righteousness to his elect totally free of charge. Let me now try to summarize this in simpler terms. Lord, forgive me for living a selfish life for most of my years on this earth. I was a decent, moral, law-abiding citizen, but I lived a godless life. I was not religious, not covetous. I was a scientist because much money was to be made by scientists, but I neglected my soul, which is worth more than all the money and wealth in the world. I was penny wise and pound foolish. I was a Gentile in the flesh and in spirit, bound for hell, and I did not know it. Then you showed up one day, and the missionary gave me a Bible. Little did he know that your irresistible grace was knocking me down. I was in church the next Sunday, and I have not missed since then. Not because I'm so good, but because I needed to hear so much from your word, the Bible, and because I needed so much to be forgiven. You gave me faith while I was hearing the gospel preached, and you gave me spiritual ears to hear. Lord, all I want to do now is live for you and give to others this great gift that one missionary gave to me. All I want to do now is tell the world that salvation is a totally free gift. I love you because you have first loved me. And then we would summarize this sermon of the saints of the past 160 years as follows. It is not that I did choose thee, for Lord, that could not be, This heart would still refuse thee, hadst thou not chosen me. Thou, from the sin that stained me, hast cleansed and set me free. Of alt thou hast ordained me, that I should live to thee. It was sovereign mercy that called me and thawed my opening mind. The world had else enthralled me to heavenly glories blind. My heart owns none before thee, for thy rich grace I thirst. This knowing, if I love thee, that thou hast first loveth me. Thank you.